That's fine. And then they just get over.
Yeah.
I don't screw up. Anyway, so.
Yeah.
This is where you don't.
Welcome back. I'm Songkit Yip. I have the pleasure to chair this section. The first talk is by Stefan Kirschner. The title is Correlation, Localization, and Liquid Phases in Models of Neural Design.
Thank you, Mr. I was first thinking I could give the talk single-handedly, but with the micro and the pointer, I'll try to manage. If you cannot hear me, let me know by some sign. All right, so let me start by thanking the organizers for the opportunity to be here. It's always nice to visit the Republic of China and to see friends here. This is the outline of my talk, and as you probably noticed when you checked with the program, I'm filling a gap here. And since this is a short session about artificial structures, and we just heard the talk about some RM hexaboride, I thought I'm talking about primarily a model which has been proposed originally to explain the metal insulator transition in some RM hexaboride, and according to one of my referees, is unrealistic. So it's artificial in some sense. And so it gives you a nice transition from the previous talk to the next talk. This is the outline. And let me start with a commonplace statement that complexity in strongly correlated systems and emergence, which is one of the topics of this conference, arises due to the interplay of interactions with frustrations and localization in part of phase space. This is a very generic statement, and what I have in mind is if you take sodium cobaltate, for example, then the phase diagram is shown here, and you see that is a complex rich phase diagram where frustration plays a role, where a curie-wise metal arises, which has features of spin physics and metallic features, and a minimal model of this sodium cobaltate is the Hubbard model, the one-band Hubbard model, perhaps the two-band Hubbard model, on a triangular lattice. Now, you have seen this sketch for geometric frustration, where icing spins live on some triangular lattice. And naively, you would expect that the large thermopower that one sees in the cobaltate comes from frustration, because the system has a large spin entropy, and the thermopower is a derivative of the entropy, and so you get a large thermopower from the spin entropy. But if you slightly go away from half filling in the Hubbard model, you are not having localized spins, you have itinerant electrons. And so the question arises, how should one think about spin frustration in a system away in the Hubbard model away from half filling? Similar questions would arise when you go to the Anderson lattice versus the Kondo lattice, where you also can have frustration and itinerant. More realistically, a question you can ask, is there a many body technique that can capture this interplay between correlation and frustration? And the standard approach to strong electron correlation is the dynamical mean field theory. which some of you know. Its main feature is that you neglect the k-dependence of the self-energy of the Queen's function, which makes it an effective quantum impurity problem. And this comes at a price when you do that. One of the triumphs of the dynamical mean field theory was that it captures the metal insulator, the mod transition. But if you think about that for a while, then you might realize that it cannot be that easy that this is captured on the single impurity level, because you replace the lattice by n being the number of lattice sites, times independent effective impurities. And in the insulating phase, you have a local moment. So you have a spin entropy in the insulating phase, which is n times, well, something. So you have a huge spin entropy that you are not getting rid of in the DMFT. Could also come from the Fermi liquid side and say, well, at the transition, the impurity is pinned by the field sum rule. And so it highly constructs what you see at the transition. These are, well, approximations in the DMFT and perhaps artifacts. It doesn't stop there. If you want to describe interplay of antiferromagnetism with superconductivity, then this is also problematic because you need finite momentum. And along the same line of argument, capturing the interplay between correlation and frustration is not fully captured in the DMFT. And so people looked for extensions of the DMFT, and there are many. One that I find particularly interesting goes by the name of dual fermion extension. This dual fermion expansion is perturbative. So you take the DMFT solution and then you perturb it. This goes back to Alex Rubtsov, Sascha Lichtenstein in Hamburg, and their collaborators. Now, the basic idea, at least for the level that we will need it in the first part of this talk, is that the lattice problem is replaced by an equivalent problem in terms of, well, fermionic decrease that are somehow dual to the original ones, that's where the name comes from, that have a K dependence. That's a good thing about this problem. And this approximation gives you continuous functions in momentum. If you do cluster approximations, then whatever you get has a discrete number of K spaces. On the downside, it's perturbative. So it's reminiscent of a Taylor expansion, and therefore you are somehow slaved to analyticity. Therefore, you would imagine that it must be very hard to get away from the DMFT solution, okay? In particular, if you want to explore phase boundaries. And the function here, where the interaction is hidden, is a fairly general one. You would expand that into four-point vertex, six-point vertex, and so on. Typically, one cannot go beyond the four-point vertex, and even taking into account all the diagrams that this four-point vertex generates is impossible. So depending on what one is looking for, one makes an educated only some diagrams in some relevant channel. Relevant means this is dependent on what you expect the problem will be. And then you could make this self-consistently, but the DMFT is an approximation that is self-consistent on the one particle level. It is self-consistent on the level of Green's functions. Here, the dual fermions, some letters based on the vertex. So this is living on the two particle level, one would say. And now making that also self-consistent introduces problems that have to do with overcount. And in what I'm going to talk about, this doesn't arise because we are not doing it fully self-consistent, but let me at least mention that there are these issues. Good. So having said that, what happens if one now takes the Hubbard model at half filling and makes this approximation? this is the phase diagram one obtains. It's published in this paper. And the dotted line is the phase boundary for the anti-ferro magnet on the square lattice. If you go to the triangular lattice, the order is pushed back. You get a spiral anti-ferro magnet. And here we have a paramagnetic metal. And the thing I would like to draw your attention to, there's a small, small region which is a candidate for a spin liquid state. Okay? And now you could say, ha, this is laughable. How can you trust that? Okay? And in some sense, this is what this talk is about. Okay, I want to ask how reliable is the approximation, and can we find at least models where we find liquid states where we are quite sure what we have. Okay, so when you ask how reliable is the approximation, then perhaps it's a good idea to ask for something universal, because the law is, if you would include more diagrams, things will shift, transition temperatures will shift. But if you have something that is universal, you would like to reproduce it. And what is universal are critical exponents. So let's look into a limit where we know the Hubbard model and where we can ask what do critical exponents give us. So the Hubbard model at half filling has for very large U a phase transition where the order parameter has O3 symmetry. And there you can measure certain extract certain critical exponents. There are traditional ones that I'm giving you here, the susceptibility, where we have an exponent gamma. Then from the correlation length, there's an exponent typically called E. And then from the spatial dependence of the susceptibility, the susceptibility is. And for the Hubbard model in three dimensions, beta is essentially zero. So if you want to test something, this is a particularly bad model. And a model which is much nicer is the Falikov-Kimball model. So this was the reason why we choose that model. These are my collaborators. There's Pedro Ribeiro, Andrei Antipov, now at Station Q. Yunis Yavamar, who is a student at MPI-PTS. Emmanuel Gull, who is in Ann Arbor. And Miguel Oliveira is another PhD student who joined us for the most recent part of this work. So, now, I already mentioned the Falikov-Kimball model, but what is this? Well, if you start from the Hubbard model and you make a simplification, which is that you keep the spin-up electrons itinerant, but you localize all the spin-down electrons, then you arrive at the Falikov-Kimball model. So it's the infinite mass balance limit of the Hubbard model. And I already mentioned it was introduced in 69 to describe the metal insulator transition in samarium hexaboride, and it's also invoked for the description of binary alloys. All right, one of the nice features of the model is that the DMFT, at least on the beta lattice, is exactly solvable. And for that reason, it has been used for many, many cases in the 90s to test the DMFT and to describe the metal insulator transition within the DMFT. At high temperatures, the model shows something like a metal insulator transition, at least within DMFT, as you increase U. And at low temperatures, you find charge order. So you find a charge density wave on the square lattice for all non-zero values of the Coulomb repulsion. If U becomes very large, you can map the model to an Ising model, because you have the C2 symmetry from the charge. And since we are in two dimensions, the Eisen model in two dimensions is well understood, and there one knows that the eta, the critical exponent eta that tells you how non-Gaussian the theory is quite large, it's 1/4. Okay? This is a relation that one has between exponents. There's a review on all these features of the model within DMFT by Furix and Belkus-Lattic. One outcome of the talk will be that I claim that this model is not metallic anywhere at half filling. Okay, so everything that the DMFT sees for the metal insulator transition should be taken with a grain of salt. Let's go and do our dual fermion approximation. We start with the DMFT, build then the dual fermions on the two particle model. From there, one gets the dual fermion Green's function, which is related to the real Green function, meaning once one has this object from the states, the charge susceptibility, and from there also critical exponents. Okay, that's what one can do. And this is the phase diagram one gets. So, temperature versus Coulomb repulsion. One sees there's something that is typically characterized as a metal. Color here means that the spectral function has a finite value near the Fermi energy. And everything that is black means you have an insulator. The blue line is the transition line from an unordered insulator into the charge density with some checkerboard order. And if you calculate the critical exponents outline, then this is what you get. Nu and gamma as a function of the Coulomb interaction. Strictly speaking, we only know that for large U, it should have the values that you see here in terms of these straight lines. They are the values for the Ising model in four dimensions, three dimensions, two dimensions. Okay, and you see that this dual fermion theory is pretty close to the exact values, which, if you think about it, is surprising. If you remember what you had to do when you calculated critical exponents for a 3D model, which is described by some four theory, you would have to do epsilon expansion starting at four dimensions. In three dimensions, epsilon is probably not small. It's a lot of work. Now, given there's also a lot of work behind setting up the program, but the fact that you only sum up a ladder that is now not about some free limit. It's a perturbation around the DMFT. But I find it very remarkable that this sort of captures the critical exponents, not only in four dimensions, where one would expect mean field, but also in three and two dimensions. And I've actually not a good explanation for why that is. Now, so this I just said. Does this have any ramifications for the Hubble model? Because after all, they're different. This is a question that's a fair question, and I would like to defer that to the discussion section at the end of my talk. Let's go back and look at the phase diagram for the moment. We have here the checkerboard order, and I just told you that at large U, where this describes the transition from an insulator to an insulator, it's described by some type of theory that we understand. If you would look at low values of the interaction, you go from something that is a fully nested Fermi surface, and you go into an ordered state. And because the Fermi surface is fully nested, you would expect, yeah, then everything is kept out. Which at least raises the question, what happens near the point here U star, where you go from the Mott insulator to the presumably metal phase. And as an aside, when we were trying to extract the exponents from the dual fermion method, we found that at around U star, the extraction of exponents became sort of iffy. That's why, if you go back to the slide with the exponents, we stopped at around a value of 5. So something seems to be going on if you approach U-Star. So what is that? And to address this issue, what's going on, I would like to look at the Falikov-Gimbel model from a slightly different perspective. Which brings me to the third point of the outline, the Falikov-Gimbel model on the square lattice, but now treated with Monte Carlo. So let's take another look at the Hamiltonian. If you look at this long enough, you will notice that the localized electrons define conserved quantities because they commute with the Hamiltonian. And you have many of those. That's a macroscopic number. And they are classical. So this model couples classical and quantum degrees of freedoms. And you have a huge number of conserved quantities. Yet, it's not a simple or integrable model, as far as I understand. There are other people here in the auditorium that could answer that. But in 1D, this model is not integrable because, and please correct me, when you go to the Hubbard model and you create a mass imbalance, integrability gets lost. All right. One more point that is important in what follows is that once you have a given realization of the localized charges, the electrons, the internal degrees of freedoms, which are spinless, are non-interacting. So all they see is a random potential. A random in quotation marks because that's given by the ensemble that you choose to look at this model. So if you have a conserved charge, then the partition function sort of can be written as a sum over contribution from each of the sectors. And once you specify the initial state to be in one of these sectors, since it's conserved, the time evolution will be only in that sector. On the other hand, if you take such a system and you couple it weakly to an environment that does not know about these conserved quantities, then it will enforce equilibration and mix different sectors. What does that mean? Well, if you take the Falikov-Kimball model and we rewrite the partition function just as I outlined on the previous slide, then you can interpret the thing that you sum over, and F means the sum over all possible configuration of the charge, as the probability for an F electron, for a given F electron configuration. And the same thing is written here, and this form, and its dependence on temperature, tells you this is a problem of annealed disorder. It's not quenched disorder, okay? So it's an annealed disorder problem. That's another way of looking at this problem. And what is the Monte Carlo algorithm doing? So we want to have a classical algorithm because we have these classical charges. We integrated out the conduction electrons that leads to an effective long-range interaction. And for this, there's no efficient cluster algorithm. So we use local updates, and you can do that canonical or macrocanonical, as indicated in these two sketches. And whatever I will show in the following is based on this Monte Carlo algorithm. So let's first look at the square lattice. This is the phase diagram one obtains, temperature versus interaction strength on the square lattice, where by and large, it looks like what we had before from the DMFT plus fermions, except that the finite system size phase diagram is richer. If we do finite size scaling, we obtain what is shown here in the inset. So this WL phase becomes fully replaced by the AI phase. And I will tell you in a moment what they are. So we also find again the checkerboard order in this charge density rate phase, where you find this checkerboard pattern, and this is the corresponding order parameter. So at large U, our Monte Carlo says, well, there's a second order phase transition, and indeed the exponents are 2D icing. That's sort of obvious. But if you go to small u, we find that the phase transition in this model now appears to be discontinuous. And the size of the actually goes away as system size increases. This is shown in this panel here, where one sees, so this is taken from this WL part of the phase diagram. You see a two-peak structure, and as system size increases, that goes away. And as it goes away, the Ising exponents in the, extend further. They extend into this AI phase, which according to DMFT was a metal. So we can also calculate specific heat and susceptibility. So let's look at. So one can of course look at this, and actually this is needed to extract the exponents. But now let's look at the AI phase and ask, is that really a metal? So the first thing one can check, of course, is the density of states. The density of states should be, are you sure? Oh, so then I should speed up a little bit. So that we check the density of states, and we check additional quantity, which is called the inverse participation ratio. And that's for the wave function.
Because we started late, sorry, you have 15, sorry.
Okay, so the IPR is a measure of whether or not the wave function is localized or not. If the wave function is delocalized and you increase the volume, you would expect that the wave function sort of goes down with volume, and that tells you you have an extended state. If the state is entirely localized, it should be independent of volume, and therefore should not scale with volume. Okay, and in order to calculate the IPR, you need a non-interacting electron problem. For interacting systems, it's not a well-defined quantity. And that's where it enters, where it's important that we have to calculate. Be that as it may, I'm showing you here the density of states and the IPR for this WL phase, the AI phase, and the insulating, the metal insulator. In the metal insulator, things are easy. The IPR says all the states are localized, it doesn't scale with L, and we have a density of states which is kept out. In the AI phase, we have a finite density of states, the Fermi energy, but the IPR tells us these states are actually localized. They are not itinerant. And in the WL phase, the system appears metallic, finite density of states and scaling of the IPR. So, we can also calculate the optical conductivity. This is shown here. And we find that neither in the AI phase, which we identify with an Anderson insulator from the IPR and the density of states, we have a Trudy peak, nor in the WL phase. But from the system size scaling of the real part of the optical conductivity, we conclude that the WL phase, which appears metallic, is where we have weak localization. There, the localization length is larger than the system size, and therefore it appears metallic. As you take the system size to infinity, you eventually cross over into the region where everything will be given at the small u side above the charge order transition by an Anderson insulator. So to sum up this part, in the two-dimensional Falikov-Gimbel model at half filling square letters, nothing is metallic. It's all insulating, and you have in this clean translationally invariant model an Anderson insulator and the mod insulator. This also implies that the transition at small u into the charge density wave is not a Stoner transition. Okay. So now for the remaining few minutes, I want to go to the triangular lattice, where we can now have frustration. And the phase diagram changes slightly. This is shown here. This is now not at half filling, it's at one-third filling. And since we don't have particle load symmetry, that makes life much harder because chemical potential has to be numerically solved for. At large temperatures, not much is changing. So we find again this WL phase, the Anderson insulator and the Mott insulator. At low temperature and large Coulomb repulsion, we find again a charge density wave, but now with a different propagation vector. We have a threefold degeneratron state. And if we calculate the restructured band structure in the charge density wave, then it's shown here, and the chemical potential for the conduction electrons lies within the gap. Reducing U now changes that band structure such that we have an indirect band closing. So it's indirect because it connects something from the center to the second band here. But this is not realized. This is under the assumption of this particular SDW order. So something happens before the charge density wave vanishes, and we find this light blue area, which we named CL and QL. So let's look again at the phase transition. We find that now, since we have a degeneracy of 3, we find universality in the three-state POTS model. Universality class, these are the exponents, these are the exactly known exponents, and they do decently well. And if you analyze the charge density wave phase by studying the susceptibility at the ordering wave vector of this order, which is given here, then you see that the susceptibility scales with the volume, which is in two dimensions, like this. Yeah. So this is really long-range order that we see here, not surprising. This is the susceptibility momentum we solve, and you see there's only weight at these particular values. You can look at this in a slightly different way by taking the susceptibility matrix and do a principal component analysis using the two largest eigenvectors. And if you do that, to plot them, this is what you find. You see that there's a degeneracy of 3 at very low temperatures. At high temperatures, it's pretty uniform. Okay, so this is all data that is a function of temperature. Again, not too surprising. But if you go now to the two liquid phases where we do not have order at low temperatures, the system looks different. So here I'm showing you the specific heat. So this is the full curve of the specific heat. It has a two-peak structure. If we focus on the low temperature feature at various U levels, there's the CDW that I just discussed. But in the CL phase and the QL phase, the behavior of this peak is different. This is shown here in the inset. It has power law behavior. And the power law behavior indicates that we have gapless excitations in both of these regions of the phase diagram. So what is going on there? Let's again plot the susceptibility momentum resolved. This is what we find. You see that the values are different from before. They are more fuzzy. And if you analyze the scaling at the point where this, let's call it quasi-order, appears, the scaling with L is much, much weaker. Here, this is the exponent for the ordered phase. This is 2. This is the exponent for these liquid phases. And if you go now and analyze you do a principal component analysis as before, and you take the three largest eigenvalues and you plot them, then you see that there's no clear feature. It remains fuzzy as a function of temperature. So there is no long-range order in these phases. What then does it mean that we see this feature, this enhancement of susceptibility at particular wave vector, at this wave vector? Well, it turns out that this wave vector is the ordering wave vector that would be realized if you would have one quarter filling. But since we enforce a one third filling, this order is not realized. So where does it come from? One guess could be that you see phase separation. So this would be a configuration if there's phase separation. This is an actual configuration that one has in the CL phase. But phase separation can be ruled out because we can sort of measure the various order parameters and how they evolve with system size as we go to larger and larger system sizes. And so here, this is the order parameter. Here you have a function of u. And then there's the one third order parameter, which vanishes as we leave the order case. And you can also plot or measure the order parameter for this one quarter order and as a function of system size in that region of the phase diagram. And you see it goes down with system size. So this is not an order parameter in that region. Okay. So that the conclusion is these are liquid states. What's the difference between the QL phase and the CL phase? Well, it's the fact that one is coupled to conduction electrons because it sits in the region where we have the Anderson insulator. And that is reflected in the specific heat having a different power law than the one where we have a fully gapped system. Okay. So these two states, they're disordered. One is having gapless excitations because of coupling to fermions. The other one is fully gapped and is classical. And this brings me to my very last part, and I'll try to be quick. This model can be, in principle, realized using ultra-cold atoms and optically defined lattices. That's one remark. The second remark is that one could imagine to sort of extend the analysis along the direction of finite, in a general phase diagram, along the direction of finite mass imbalance. And so it's an open question how much of this will survive. With regard to the phase transition, the first part, the critical exponents that I discussed, and it's standard law that at least for a classical phase transition, only the order parameter symmetry and the spatial dimension matter. And therefore, although the four-point vertex in the Falikov-Kimball model is simple, it's entirely static here. There's no dynamics. one could imagine that in a local theory, like a DMFT, the order parameter symmetry is captured by the DMFT level, and the dynamics that enters because of the more complicated vertex doesn't really matter because dynamics is irrelevant at the classical phase transition. So based on these universality arguments, one would imagine that the method would equally well perform if you go to the Hubbard model. Now, how about the second aspect of my talk, that of intrinsic annealed disorder? Is that something that is artificial because it comes with the Falikov-Kimball model, or could one imagine that one finds this also in realistic generic models like the Hubbard model? Well, you could, I guess, argue that if you start from the partition function of a general many-body Hamiltonian and you make Hubbard-Sartanovich decoupling and integrate out the fermionic degrees of freedom so that everything only depends on the Hubbard-Sartanovich field, and you now look at the dynamics of the Hubbard-Sartanovich field, that you might encounter a regime, this quasi-static regime, where only the zero Matsubara frequency is relevant, so you can drop it. And if you then look at the part where you integrated out your original fermions, in there, at very high temperatures, these objects should scale like T squared. So there, you might be able to also discard the temperature dependence. And if that is true, you encounter a model which shows annealed disorder. This is sort of a guess, okay, that it might go through. Whether or not this is really true needs to be seen. However, the fact that at the phase transition, only static matter, only the static matters, if it's a classical finite temperature phase transition, is essentially the same reason. So I think there's a good chance that some of these arguments go through for that. And with that, I would like to summarize. My time is up, so I think the Falikov-Gimbel model is an interesting model. It has very rich physics. Whether or not this is an artifact or more general needs to be seen. And with that statement, I thank you for your interest or your patience. That's now your call. Thank you very much.
We have a little bit of time, one or two questions. Yeah, okay.
I had a question about the first part, the, with the dual fermions. So when you have this diagrams, so this is only the ladders, right? So the question is, do you know, is there a way to put in other diagrams like the bubble diagrams or other channels, or you have some way to argue that those are lossy?
Yeah, but for the Falikov-Gimbel model, you would have two sort of levels. There's actually, there's the APR, the sum of bubbles, which is actually the thing that goes in here. And there's a true ladder. In general, depending on the vertex, you would have different channels, particle hole channel, or channel, something like this. And if you want to combine them, you would go and do a parquet type of approximation. I don't think that has been really implemented, but this is the philosophy that you would follow. And this is physics that has been around for a long time. And the special feature is that you do it not around the free limit, but around the DMFT. And I can only repeat what I said before. I find it very surprising that one finds the true or pretty good exponents.
A little bit fortuitous.
I don't know, but it's not entirely obvious to me how to approach the problem to understand what's going on, because you have to juggle a lot of diagrams.
One more, maybe short one, please.
Yes, a short one. In the case of covalence that you mentioned at the beginning, you have situations where the correlations are ferromagnetic between sides, although you have triangularities, you still have ferromagnetic layers. Would you explain that?
Do I have to? This was mainly the motivation. We could argue whether or not the single band Hubbard model is a good model for sodium cobaltate. And there the answer is no. Maybe that's the answer that you want to hear. Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. I think we have to move on.